In this lecture, we'll learn about the two types of star clusters, how they fit into our Milky Way galaxy, and how we measure their ages. All stars are born from giant clouds of gas. Because a single cloud can contain enough material to form many stars, stars usually form in groups. These groups are known as star clusters, and in addition to being some of the most beautiful objects in the night sky, they are also very useful to astronomers. The reason star clusters are so useful is because all of the stars in a cluster lie at about the same distance from Earth, and all the stars in a cluster formed at about the same time. Astronomers can therefore use star clusters as laboratories for comparing the properties of stars that all have similar ages. There are two basic types of star clusters, the modestly sized open clusters and the densely packed globular clusters. Open clusters are found in the disk of our galaxy and tend to be young in age. They can contain up to several thousand stars and typically are about 30 light years across. Globular clusters are found in the halo of the galaxy, and their stars are among the oldest in the universe. A globular cluster can contain more than a million stars concentrated in the shape of a ball, typically from 60 to 150 light years across. One of the most famous open clusters is the Pleiades, a grouping of stars in the constellation of Taurus. 47 to Canae is an example of a globular cluster. It's almost 17,000 light years away from Earth. Now let's look at how these two types of clusters fit into the Milky Way. We've never been able to get outside of our galaxy to take an overhead image. It's simply too enormous. But if we could, it would look something like this figure. The spiral arms are part of a fairly flat disk of stars surrounding a bright central bulge. The entire disk is surrounded by a dimmer, rounder halo. Open clusters are found in the disk, and globular clusters are found in the halo. We divide our galaxy into three components, or populations. There is the disk population, the halo population, and the central bulge, or nucleus, of the galaxy. Let's begin with the disk stars. If you could stand outside the Milky Way and watch it for a few billion years, the disk would resemble a huge merry-go-round. The individual stars circle around the disk and they bob up and down as they do, like merry-go-round horses. As a star orbits, if it overshoots and moves above or below the disk, the mass of the galaxy will pull it back. This is what gives stars their up and down motions. The stars near us take about 200 million years to make one orbit around the galaxy, and one up and down bob takes a few tens of millions of years. The orbits of halo stars are much more elliptical, and the orientations are relatively random. The halo stars can go thousands of light years above and below the disk. The orbits of bulge stars are also more elliptical, with relatively random orientations. The differences in the orbits of the disk, bulge, and halo stars offer astronomers clues to how our galaxy formed. Let's go back to our star clusters. Remember, clusters are useful because they are the same distance from us, and all the stars in the cluster formed at the same time. We can therefore determine cluster ages by plotting their stars on an HR diagram. Consider the Pleiades. Most of the stars in the Pleiades are on the main sequence, with one exception. At the upper end of the main sequence, stars trail away to the right. Therefore, the hot, short-lived stars of spectral type O are missing from the main sequence. These stars are missing because the Pleiades cluster is old enough for its main sequence O stars to have already ended their hydrogen-fusing lives, but it's young enough that some of its spectral type B stars still reside on the main sequence. The precise point on the HR diagram at which a cluster of stars diverge from the main sequence is called the main sequence turnoff point. For the Pleiades, it occurs around spectral type B6. The main sequence lifetime of a B6 star is roughly 100 million years, so this must be the age of the Pleiades. Any star in the Pleiades that was born with a main sequence spectral type hotter than B6 had a lifetime shorter than 100 million years and is no longer found on the main sequence. over the next few billion years, the B stars in the Pleiades will die out, followed by the A stars and the F stars. If we could make an HR diagram for the Pleiades every few million years, we would find its main sequence gradually growing shorter. This figure compares the main sequence of other star clusters. In each case, the age of the cluster is equal to the lifetimes of the stars at its main sequence turnoff point. The older the cluster is, the more stars that have turned off the main sequence, and the redder its turnoff point. This is the bottom line. The age of the cluster is equal to the lifetimes of the stars at its main sequence turnoff point. This technique of identifying main sequence turnoff points is a very powerful tool that allows us to determine the ages of star clusters. We've discovered that globular clusters are about 13 billion years old, making them the oldest known objects in the galaxy. If determining cluster age by main sequence turnoff point is confusing, think about it some more and then try to explain it to someone else. That is a great way to really learn something. Take care, enjoy your day, I'll talk to you again soon.